First of all, you don't know me.
We're all about that high school drama girl, all about them high school queens. We'll take you for a ride in our comic girl,
drama girl,
cheering for the right team.
Drama queens, drama queens,
smart girl, rough girl, fashion, but you're tough girl, you could sit with us girl.
Drama queens, drama queens, drama queens, drama, drama queens, drama queens.
Wow.
The finale.
It really was one of the best episodes we've ever done.
I
loved that.
I shouldn't have eaten this Thai soup. God, it stressed me out so much. And, like, the soup plus the stress. Terrible idea. This is going to be a long day, girls.
Oh, my God. Honey. It was very emotional. Guys, we're on season 3, episode 22. The show must go on. Our season 3 finale, which originally aired on May 3rd, 2006.
I mean, Joy, this episode was massive for you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was huge. This was the one that the story when I had to drive from Atlanta, when I hired somebody to drive me from Atlanta. It was the limousine day, the limousine going off the edge of the...
Oh, my God.
Yeah, they had a helicopter. They had all the stunts. You know, it was all the underwater scuba guys. Tim McKinney, who we were talking about on our live tour earlier this week, who was one of our crew guys, was out there. I just remember him sitting out on that river like all day long, just on a plank. The camera was on, I feel like they had the camera on like a, it kind of looked like a little dock, like a mini dock, but it was floating in the middle of the ocean, mm-hmm. or the ocean, the river, floating in the middle of the river.
It was like a barge.
Yeah, it was a barge. Thank you.
Barge?
Yeah,
it was a camera barge.
And Matt Dahl. And yeah, the guys are out there, and there's so much that goes into something like that with the electricity underwater, and you've got actors who are in a car underwater and they can't just get out easily. So they had to have oxygen tanks, and I mean, it was a huge, huge episode.
Well, didn't they shoot all of the inside car stuff on the tank on stage? Like, surely they didn't shoot that in the river, did they? Because that's disgusting.
The car stuff?
When we see Rachel and Cooper and James underwater, in Wilmington, they were trying to build film, and they had just built this massive tank on one of the stages.
I don't know if it had been done by then. We were there all day.
Yeah.
As far as I remember, they'd shot everything in that river underwater.
Oof. That's bananas.
Gross.
Well, just for you, how much heads up did you have, like, that this wedding was going to go off the rails and be, like, there are 37 cliffhangers at the end of this thing in hopes that
it was a great
we didn't
script.
Get canceled.
Yeah, I know. Who's pregnant?
I loved
is
this
Is it Haley,
script.
Brooke, Rachel?
We know Karen is.
Were
Haley and Karen pregnant at the same time? I guess I forgot that, if that was the case. I guess we were. I got the script the same time as everybody else did. I did. That's all. I just found out when the script came, like a week before we shot it or whatever. It was a big deal. It was a really, really big episode. But it was huge for you guys too. I mean, this is a major turning point for Brooke and Peyton.
Really big for everyone.
You did such a good job. You were so sad this whole episode.
Gosh.
I felt terrible.
I know.
Yeah, poor Brooke.
Heartbreaking stuff.
Yeah, I'm also going to defend Peyton because Brooke keeps saying, I have so much going on. And I'm like, hi.
You're like, my
shot,
mom just died.
Dead mom. Like,
same. Lots going on.
Same. And Sophie and I, we laughed during this because it's like, really? We're going to go this hard over a high school boy?
A high school boy. Yeah, I think, you know, I remember... Because that was our complaint then, too.
Yeah, we were just like, all the way? You want us to go all the
like,
way?
Like, really?
Okay.
But, you know, you have to lean into the drama. You have to lean into the conflict so that there can eventually be resolution and people can grow. It's like, you have to figure out a way to make it true. And so the thing that I remember having to really lean in on was the betrayal of it. Because to me, betrayal is like, I think everyone has... I call it a nuclear emotion, the thing that just makes you scorched earth.
Yeah, yeah.
And betrayal is a scorched earth thing for me.
Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, I guess that's what I have to really try to draw on and think about and have it be about the fact that my person, my best friend, continues behind my back to have these experiences with the man that I'm in a relationship with, like, what does that do? How does that destabilize a person and make them feel like they can't trust anyone around them? And I do feel like, for as silly as it was that Brooke and Peyton were fighting over a high school boy, I feel like that sense of being rudderless worked.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are breakups in female friendships that feel worse than divorce.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've had them in my own personal life.
Yeah. Same.
I had them as a teenager. I've had them as an adult. And yep. It's just like, you mourn them, and then sometimes you come back together and it's magic. But those blowouts are unlike any kind of fight with a dude. Like, with a dude, you're fighting with two different sets of tools.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you're with a woman, it's like, we're both expert fencers. We're going to try to stab each other right now, and let's see who bleeds. And yeah, for me, growing up, my girlfriends and I would kiss the same dude and think it was awesome. We'd be like, man, like, he was at my house on Saturday and your house on Sunday, and isn't really? That hilarious? Oh, yeah, we thought we were so funny doing that.
I didn't have that.
Yeah, I didn't really? Either.
Never.
Oh, yeah, we were just like, he thinks that we like him.
Oh,
that's amazing, the wherewithal to just be like, no, oh, whatever, this is like so silly.
By the way, that's how it should be.
Yeah, you got just all kiss the same person and then you can compare notes.
Like, who would, because it's not going to matter. You're 15, like, nothing matters. But, oh, yeah, I remember, God, I had like a best friend in junior high and high school. And then she liked a boy in high school who said he liked me.
Uh-huh.
Nothing happened with anybody, by the way.
Yeah.
They'd never been on a date. We'd never been on a date. He just was like, yeah, that girl who like goes to camp is more my type. And she literally like basically told me I was the worst person on the planet. And I was yeah. like, I don't think I even have a dog in this fight. Like, I didn't sign up for this. So it's weird thinking about all of it. It's interesting that you guys were so, I don't know, chill, progressive. Oh, I don't yeah. know what the word is. And that so many people aren't. And I'm having this really meta moment where I'm like, are girls not chill about dumb boys because TV teaches us not to be? Like, where did we learn?
Oh, no, did we do this to ourselves?
Did we do this Damn to ourselves?
We help do right. this a terrible
kiss,
thing?
What does she say? She says a kiss never means nothing.
A kiss always means a kiss something.
Joy goes, that's bullshit.
She goes, no, not true.
Doesn't.
Not true. I was looking for somebody to kiss last night. I didn't need Word. To mean anything.
Stop.
Kidding me?
Is that what you were doing out on the phone outside our restaurant?
You're just no, can you imagine? I'm just like scrolling.
No, there's
like,
a lot of handsome men in D.C.
Hey, that's true.
They're really successful.
Yeah.
You know?
Smart.
Polished.
Political.
Yeah.
But it doesn't always need to mean something. It's just, you know, sometimes a kiss is just a kiss. I mean, if you're in a relationship, that's a problem. You gotta not do that when you're in a relationship, kiss other people, but.
I mean, yes, correct. No, those are the rules.
Yeah. But look, we've said it before and we'll say it a million times. When you're single, you should kiss whoever you want.
You should absolutely kiss whoever you want. You should have fun with your girlfriends tag teaming. I mean, honestly, I feel for Peyton because when I was in school, I had a super, super beautiful best friend and everyone wanted to date her. And the only time they would want to date me is like as a consolation prize. And so I can see Peyton taking the scraps, you know, where it's like, yeah, just whatever's left over from everybody else's stuff. Like, that'll work, you know?
Yeah.
And as much as Brooke has attachment problems, Peyton also has attachment problems.
Mm-hmm.
And anybody that Peyton has had a relationship with is finding all this happiness with her friends. Like, she dated Nathan and that was really toxic. And now, wow, what a great guy he is with Haley, you know? Lucas was like really shifty and also kind of manipulative with like Peyton being at her absolute lowest. And now he's showing up and writing all these letters for Brooke. Mm-hmm. And so there is a thing about taking the scraps when you're a teenager because you can't think bigger.
And that may have been what Jake was tapping into with why he sort of sent Peyton away.
He deserves more than the
scraps.
Consolation prize.
But that's what I think is so... Not,
you weren't the consolation prize, though. Peyton never was.
No, he felt like the consolation prize.
I think he was worried that he might be, that he wasn't sure if he was really the one for you.
He wanted you to be sure.
He wanted you to know that neither of you are the consolation prize and that it's not like, oh, Jake's a default because I can't have Lucas.
Right.
You know?
But what I find so interesting about that is that this idea of feeling like a consolation prize or taking the scraps is something everyone goes through.
Yeah.
Because somebody who, there will always be someone who looks at each of us or each of you as like the number one ideal. And it always changes. It's like, there are times when, even in this show, when Lucas is like, it's Peyton. And then he's like, it's Brooke. And then he's like, it's Peyton. And
he's
everyone,
so confusing.
He's confusing. But like, it's just wild. Like even hearing you say, oh, I had this pretty friend in high school and like this guy, like whatever. It's crazy to me because I'm like, oh my God, when I remember even at this wedding, like us being in the same dresses and just feeling so insecure, looking at you and being like, she is so pretty. I don't want to stand next to her in this dress.
What are you talking about? I have a hunchback this whole episode. So
you look gorgeous. I remember watching you in that red dress too. I was like, damn. Yeah.
And like, I had this terrible, like half to the side mushroom haircut and my bangs were growing out. And I had never felt less pretty.
You looked like a doll.
I had never felt less pretty.
I mean, yes, we all and own so, our own like.
Yeah. But it's just interesting, like that we can all be made to feel like we're the less than person by somebody whose opinions might change month to month anyway. Like,
we're perfectly capable of making ourselves feel that way without anyone else's input.
Oh, yeah. By the way, we don't help. But it's like, it's
you,
just,
over there.
Isn't it just so wild that everybody can be in their own little bubble being like, oh no, I'm the weird one. Oh no. Yeah. And I don't even know where I'm going with it. It's wild. It's wild to hear you say it, knowing how I've felt it and knowing that it is a thing that we universally experience. And I'm like, man, when are we going to let that go?
I don't know.
Probably never. Well, no, you know what? You know what was really fun is when we did our first photo shoot for Drama Queens, and we hadn't done a photo shoot together since we were little kids.
Yes.
And people used to make us feel like really competitive in those situations. Yeah. And it was like jockeying for who was going to wear the best outfit and like, you know, who was going to get these shoes and whose leg, you know, was going to be
sitting
out
in what position in the photo.
And there was so much jockeying that when we did that shoot and we didn't have any art directors and we didn't have like stylists from the network or the studio, we didn't have any voices in our heads other than our owns. Mm. Our owns. Yeah, that's
it's all our owns.
But we just all kind of looked at each other and we're like, okay, we're doing this different, right? And there was this mutual agreement that like, let's not do it like that, you know? And the opening up of the suitcases, if you will, is so helpful.
It's so much easier now.
I just bring undergarments.
And we just
I can't bring
fun.
The on-top clothes, but I will bring you two undergarments fucking anywhere.
Yes, yes. Give me all the shape-shifting undergarments that you have. I loved that because it's so much easier now as older women to be supportive and really like now that we're settled into, I love who I am, where I am in life. I'm comfortable with myself. There's always going to be flaws that I see in the mirror and I've grown accustomed to them and love them in my own way. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you guys do too. So it's not, there's not this sense of when you're so young, you're looking to the women around you, the girls around you. And I was anyway, I think sounds like you guys were too, to just sort of we're figuring out who we are. So it's like, well, if my nose looked more like that, then I could be more like that person. Or if I was just a little taller, or if I was skinnier, or if I was bigger or whatever, like if I only, I could be. And it's weird. It's weird to, you know, I guess weird is the wrong word. It's nice, actually. It's nice to be able to be settled in who we are so we can all come together and not feel competitive.
Yeah. Well, and I also think after a while, you realize, oh, everybody feels this.
Yeah.
Everyone has their fill in the blank. What story have we been sold that's made us waste so much time worrying that we're not enough of this or too much of that? Like, just the brain space.
Well, and after a couple proven decades of like, I can still get it.
Yeah.
Even when I'm feeling insecure.
Well, we were talking about caveman instincts. This is caveman stuff.
Yeah.
This is like the basics of evolutionary science where, you know, you
the breeding part.
It's the breeding thing. It's like we want to be the most attractive so that we can be the most safe Because if you're the most safe, then you've got the protection of the clan or the biggest of the cavemen.
Yeah.
It's some weird, deep, deep old tribal instinct. So I don't know that it will ever go away, but we certainly have tools to take care of it.
Did you guys ever read that book, Sex at Dawn?
No.
It's all about how humans evolved and the psychology of relationships, sexuality, femininity, what's been oppressed, what's been supported.
Different cultures throughout the world,
it will just blow your mind.
Okay.
And you'll go, oh, when you talk about that sort of caveman brain, I don't know why I've always referred to it as like lizard brain, because I'm like, it's this weird little part of our brains that comes from before we were supposed to be these higher self people. And I think it's that desire to survive that's hardwired, which also is what can make us such nightmares with scarcity mentality.
Yeah.
You know, the myth that there isn't enough to go around makes us all crazy.
Yeah.
Is that why we're hoarders?
Maybe. Is that why we have like an apocalypse shelter? Just in case.
Just in case.
That fits because Nathan, who is this like protector, Joy, you were saying when we watched the episode, you're like, oh my God, what a hero.
When he dives off that bridge.
Into that water.
I'm still on a soapbox about James needing an action hero movie career.
Yeah.
He is such a hero. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's effortless for him. Like there's never a question of whether or not Nathan's going to go into that water.
Yeah. Mm-mm.
And that dive. Who knew? That was really James.
I know. It was great.
I wouldn't have done it. There's no fucking way. If I had been handed a script that said Hillary Burton jumps off a bridge into some dirty water, that would have happened. There would have been a man in a blonde wig.
Are you serious?
Never.
Oh, I would have fucking done it.
Really?
Yes. Here's the thing.
That's why I love acting. That's the fun of it.
No. I want to stand real still. Get my mark.
Right. Oh my God, sign me up to get dirty. I'm in.
I love nothing more than doing stunts. I like all the action adventure shit. But what I'm going to tell you right now is, would I have done that in North Carolina in a river? No, because there were gators.
Snakes.
And there is no way.
Oh yeah, no, if I knew it was safe. If it was unsafe, I wouldn't have done it for sure.
I think it was always a little unsafe, Joy.
We live in a treacherous time.
They'd always be like, you'll be fine.
Yeah, we get staph infections. You're fine.
Don't worry about it. You got some antibiotics.
Go away.
I remember going to do a movie in Louisiana in the early 2000s and being like, hey, should I get some hepatitis shots? Because I knew I was going to have to do a whole bunch of water work. Maybe that's what ruined it.
Oh,
I was doing like all this like swamp work. I was like, do I need to get hep shots or anything weird? And they're like, oh, yeah. You should get all of those. And I'm like, how come no one in Wilmington was ever like, hey, you're going to be in the swamps? We should get you some shots.
Yeah, dirty water above the waist is real. It's scary. I mean, depending on how long you're in it. Yeah. I even did a kayak down the LA River when I was like,
what?
I don't know about how I feel about this, sitting in this kayak right now. I definitely drank a lot of water and just peed for a while after.
You're just like just praying not to capsize.
Clean it all out.
Oh,
gross.
Oh no. This episode's called TMI. I love those episodes, guys. I mean, what happened at the beginning of the episode?
Well, here's what the basic recap is. We have Dan and Deb. We've got Karen and Dan.
Yeah.
We've got Rachel and Cooper. And then Lucas, Brooke, Peyton, and Nathan and Haley. Those are the four. And Mouth was
sweet,
there.
Sweet, sad DJ.
Sweet, sad DJ. I wish he had a little more meat, but we were kind of filled up with that episode.
That episode was bananas. I remember we spent like half a day shooting the Michelle Featherstone music.
Yeah.
Because the labels would let us have artists, but we had to basically shoot a music video, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And they gave her a couple lines with Cooper.
Yeah, they did. She had that sweet British accent.
She came back, though, didn't she? She came back later and played Trick, I think.
She did?
Did she?
I don't remember.
I liked her. I like her music a lot.
Did you spend time with her?
A little bit. We didn't go hang out outside of work. I remember sitting back and chatting with her on the off time. Because those were long days. I mean, a wedding episode.
These finale episodes and the weddings.
And finale, yeah.
God, whether we had a concert at Trick or a wedding, you knew you were in for like basketball days. You were like, here we go. It's going to be 18 hours. I better bring a knitting needle or a Mad Libs book.
Yeah.
Mad Libs. And we also, every single one of us had to be done up. Like,
yeah.
It's one thing to do everyday makeup. It's another thing to have to do heightened event hair and makeup.
Mm-hmm.
And so we would have to start shooting the second the sun came up. So we would have as many daylight hours as possible. So we were going into work at like 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning so that all, like literally every woman on the show was being done.
Yeah.
And we, you're there at like 3:30. You start shooting at like 6:30. No, you have a rehearsal at 6 a.m.
Yeah.
Dawn breaks at 6:30. And then you're just fucking in it till 7:30.
Well, that's why you said we all had our hair up. Remember, because I've come in with that sun-kissed t-shirt. We had to get it in somewhere.
Get it in there.
Karen has her hair up. I've got my hair up. Then, Sophia, you've got your hair up for the next episode.
Yeah, when I'm setting up the wedding.
Yep. And then all the wedding stuff is hair up, locked in place.
Hairspray.
Like, we do not. I guarantee you, in that pre-production meeting, they sat the hair department down and they said, we do not have time for hair.
Oh, I guarantee you the hair department sat our bosses down said, we cannot do all these girls with their hair down like you like it. So either you let us put their
voice.
Hair up.
Say in JoJo's voice.
You're either going to let us put their damn hair up or you're going to need to give us an extra day on this episode.
That's right.
Yeah.
Or we need four more hair people.
You know how expensive four hair people are?
I know.
They had to make it really, really easy. I remember just sitting around so much on this episode.
Oh, really?
And I seem to remember like Bevan and Daniil like getting into some mischief.
It feels like they would have. We were on a huge property.
Yeah.
We were at Orton and it was like just a massive property. It was so beautiful, but we were definitely like, there was a lot to do on off time. Lots of places to wander and explore.
Well, that's it. We're like stray cats too. Because they're like, what's around this corner? Oh, look, there's the river. I'm going to walk to it. You know?
Is it? It makes me uncomfortable though to look back and know where we were filming.
Yeah.
Well, and I know, listen, we were like, we were in a very small town in the old South.
Every old house we shot in had conflicted history.
Yeah. And like, there weren't really, it's not like we were somewhere like New York where there's a million locations. Like, there's not a lot of places to go, but I don't know. It just makes me feel.
Well, the place where we had Dan's funeral, that was a old home. Remember like the fake dream funeral? That was an old home with some conflicted history. Like, we ended up shooting in a lot of places that were places where we wouldn't necessarily go today because plantation culture is gross, you know? And it's gross to put a shiny gloss on it. And so I think our show was more enamored with the fact that Firestarter filmed there.
Yeah.
The first big movie that came to Wilmington was Firestarter with Drew Barrymore.
Yeah.
And it shot
there.
She
was little.
She was a baby. And that was when people were like, oh, this town has some neat elements. We should do more here. So that was more the nod I think our show was making.
What I will say, as uncomfortable as it is, and for as many things as they failed at, I do appreciate that given the constraints of just what was available and that we did end up there, I do appreciate that the powers that be filmed 98% of what you saw was just in the garden.
Yeah.
Like we didn't do it. We didn't like,
they weren't glamorizing the columns.
The columns and the actual structure of it. And I don't know. I don't have an answer. I'm just, I just feel that like feeling when we talk about it.
Well, because we wouldn't go back.
Yeah.
I remember getting lost back there. There's like all these abandoned buildings in those woods because I shot a couple things there.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's so much on that property. It's wild.
It's wild.
Like a lake in the middle of that property.
Yeah, it's huge. I think the only other, I mean, Airlie is, how big was Airlie Gardens?
That had a lake too, didn't it?
Yeah, that was also massive. And didn't that used to be the Joneses' property? It was like Airlie and Landfall. And then, this is a fun little tidbit for you guys at home. The phrase, this is what I've been told. I believe it's true. The phrase, keeping up with the Joneses, literally came from this family who is like the wealthiest, one of the wealthiest families.
In Wilmington?
And it was in Wilmington called the Joneses.
Whoa.
And they
didn't they build the Biltmore?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, it was Pembroke Jones.
Pembroke Jones, that's right.
Oh.
That's right. And they had this massive, massive, massive property in Wilmington that has now been split up into Airlie Gardens and Landfall and the golf course and all this other stuff. But that was all the Joneses' property. So you wanted to keep up with the Joneses.
I love that Sophia noticed that the reception was over and it was still daylight outside.
Yeah, that felt sad.
Well, no, it felt like the budget of high schoolers, where it's like, you know, when you're buying the wedding packages,
yeah,
and
I
you're
guess
like,
that's true.
Am I going to get the full bar that goes till 2 a.m.? I'm going to do the brunch wedding.
Let's that's
do the
right.
Let's do the morning this into is the lunch.
Cost effective, man.
Yeah, oh, and you gosh. Get your friend Mouth to be the DJ. Oh,
I loved it. AstroTurf inside that tent.
AstroTurf in the tent. Everything was purple. Guys, why did our set designers like purple so much? Even Lee Norris's tie.
Yeah.
Him in the DJ booth with those big headphones on. His tie was like gray and purple and lavender stripes.
Wow. They really were obsessed with purple.
Purple
and red and white. That was it. Maybe that was like they were given that note by the studio or something. Like, keep the look. These are the color schemes, what we like for this show. Keep it.
What are the color schemes for other shows? What we need is like a Pinterest mood board palette.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure Sophia can coordinate that.
Yeah.
I feel like Dawson's Creek was like yellows and greens and oranges.
The orange, I was going to say.
Mm. Yeah.
Orange.
We based everything for Good Sam on like a really beautiful like peacock teal and a copper.
Mm.
Those were our base colors, and we evolved everything
out of that. Uh-huh.
And it was pretty.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like my husband's show is just kind of like brown.
Yeah, it's just muddy. That's what I think of when I think of Walking Dead. Just dirty.
Just brown and gray.
Brown
What's
and
your
blood.
Color palette? It's brown.
It's like a Cormac McCarthy novel come to life.
But that's it. When you think about the color palettes of your shows, that's an interesting. I never thought to decorate my home in like my favorite color palettes from TV shows.
Oh, yeah. Mm.
I'm going to fall down that rabbit hole later today. I bet it exists. The internet's vast.
Yeah. There's an account that I follow on Instagram that does the Pantone breakdowns of films.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
Nice. It is my favorite.
Ooh, send me like that Wes Anderson I will. Pantone.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about Rachel and Cooper.
Danielle was so good.
She was really
in that
good.
Scene in the
really
car. Good. My God.
Wow.
Well, she was good, like, being sloppy, too. Because we've all been
hurt.
The mad girl. Like, I've acted out, believe it or not.
It's interesting because we've been saying about Rachel that she sort of had this bird's eye view of everything, that she seemed so unbothered by so many things, mm-hmm. especially by Brooke. It just was like she was so easy to shrug things off. So it's interesting to see this character all of a sudden just, we found her Achilles heel.
Yeah, it's a boy. And
but it's an older guy. I don't know, it's interesting to me.
Well, it's the value that attention gives you. And
she did so badly just want to be older and out of high school and over it all.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Rachel.
And to be loved by the trophy guy. That, you know, Rachel has this storyline that she built herself into a trophy girl.
That's right.
To
feel
like
she
was worthy.
Which she had a term that she used, right? With Mouth. Or no, with Jimmy Edwards.
And
she
was like,
the elite girl.
She made herself an elite girl, guys.
That's right.
And, you know, the NASCAR superstar, that's a pretty elite guy. And she, I think there is that thing of wanting to be worthy. And she really brought that Rachel backstory into this storyline in a way as an actor that was so beautiful. And you could see the hurt and the rage and that sort of anger and that acting out. It's just a mask for your wound.
Yeah.
And to see her act out first and then kind of drop the mask and be this heartbroken girl.
Yeah.
The little girl thing was really jarring to see. Like she
was
once
really acting like a little
off,
girl.
She's a little kid.
Yeah.
Like a little like puffy little kid face.
Her makeup was splotchy. So she just looked so young and sad and scared.
Yeah. Wait, what do we think she was going to tell Cooper?
I think she said she's pregnant.
Surely not all the girls made that announcement on the same day.
phone.
Brooke was worried. Karen is pregnant. Haley, I think, is also pregnant.
Yeah, I think Haley's pregnant, but isn't this going to be when Brooke kind of takes the fall for Haley being pregnant for a little bit?
I guess so.
Remember?
I forgot that happened.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you guys weren't talking to me at that point because
we really stole.
Brooke doesn't love Peyton anymore.
We really stole storylines from Friends.
We did?
That's a total, yes, when Rachel's pregnant and Monica takes the hit for her for like 2 or 3 episodes.
Oh, I missed that season, I think.
Well, apparently the writer's room didn't.
Well, also, there's just only so many things people can do.
Yeah, that's
true. Like, when you get pregnant, you either tell people or you don't. As a girl, you're either pregnant or you're not.
We need a mash, you know, one of those little mash, like, paper things.
Oh, yeah.
So we're pregnant, not pregnant.
Yeah.
Mansion
tell,
house.
Don't tell.
Yeah.
Single, partnered. You know, I don't know. There's like not that many things that happen to everybody. So I kind of get it, but I didn't know that they did that on Friends.
Yeah. Anyway, you know, so that might be coming up.
So we copied their poster and then we copied their story.
That's right. I love the accuracy, though, of showing how fucking stressed out everyone was behind the scenes of this wedding, because everyone wants it to be so perfect for Nathan and Haley. But meanwhile, all the friends are imploding. And so that walk down the aisle where everyone is faking smiles and Deb is like, I hate you so much. Yeah. And like, Brooke and Peyton are talking shit to each other. Like, everyone is faking it. And I have been at those weddings where people are just like, this sucks, huh? Okay, cool. How are we going to get out of here? There's like, you know, there's so much work to do. And when you are close to the bride and groom, you want to be the people that do it, that like show up and do it.
Yeah.
And so I've been at weddings where I've like done all the hair and makeup or done the flower arrangements or done whatever. And you end up looking like shit at the wedding. And you're so tired at the ceremony. And you're just like, let's get this over with.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Just say your thing. Yeah. We all know you love each other. Go ahead.
Okay. We done now?
We're so happy for you. We're also so tired.
We're so tired. Yeah, it's true.
That, I think, has been the greatest lesson for me of this stage we're in as grownups, is making sure if you ask people to come to something, they don't have to work. Because all of our friends are helpers. Like, that's what we do.
Well,
we jump in and go, what do you need? Let me get it. I got that. Hold on. Let me get the bag and I'll do the thing and I'll run around the corner to the store to get you the tights, the whatever it is. And God, when you can invite people to something and be like, for real, all you have to do is drink a glass of wine.
That's it. Yeah.
Enjoy. Like, that is the marker for me of adulthood.
Yeah. We're not doing a school project right now, friends.
That's right.
Drink your wine.
Speaking of helping out, how about Dan starting out by tying Lucas's tie?
Ew.
That was so gross. And I was also confused by Dan in this episode.
Well, the way he wanted to father Lucas in that moment, to be parental.
Yeah.
And then the way that he went to Karen and hugged her. Oh, I hated it.
I had a totally opposite reaction.
What? Oh, my God. It made me so uncomfortable. I was so upset when he touched her.
Yeah, I got grossed out.
I know. You guys were like grossed out. I think I was like, I was looking at Paul's face and seeing how remorseful Dan was. And I think
sure,
also,
but
no, I know. Dan, you know, he does it. He does it. And then he takes it back. And then he does crazy things. And then he apologizes. And then I mean, that's just his habit. We know he's like a nut. But I think as a single mom, having done all that work myself, the idea of hearing that from the one person who never, you know, would have said, Dan never, ever said that to Karen. And the idea that he would have taken a moment to say, I never apologized for how I treated you. And the way you could tell he was actually really wrought. And I know he's a narcissist. I know he's a nut. But that moment, like, meant something to me as a single mom. I was like, wow, that to hear that from the one person who, you know, never did or would never say that, it's like, oh my God, that's so meaningful. And I understood exactly why she confessed that she was pregnant in that moment. Like, knowing their history, knowing like everything that they've, it's you, once you're tied in so tightly with someone, the good and the bad all kind of come out at the same time sometimes, I think. I understood his instinct to want to care and her instinct to go to him. It wasn't like she actually trusted him. I didn't feel that she was, by letting him hug her or by accepting that moment of safety from him, it didn't feel like she was like, okay, now forever we're friends and you can take care of my baby.
No.
But there was it was like a peacemaking moment. And I just appreciated the moment of like two people who really, really had so much awful things pass between them to have a moment of peace.
I guess, and it's interesting to hear the way you say it, because yes, there are things I've experienced where I would love somebody to say, wow, I'm really sorry. Like, that would be so nice.
But not like validating, not like, oh, finally they said it. It's like, it's just, you hunger for that sort of like.
Well, but that's what I mean. Yeah. Like, it would be nice to receive that.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not waiting for it. But once you said it, I went, yeah, that would actually be really interesting. I think what gave me that like creepy crawly feeling was he was so clearly in this moment of realization of his own monstrous behavior. And it just comes out because he is speaking about Keith with sadness. She doesn't know why, obviously. And I don't know.
He's so desperate for to be redeemed.
Sure, but I guess to me it felt like he wanted to be the good guy or like,
that's it. It's still based
really?
In
the,
yeah.
For me, our boss, the two sides to that coin are half of him was mouth and half of him was Dan Scott. And he was processing his own ego bullshit through those two characters. And so he's the Dan Scott of my life, right? Where it's like, I'm going to pretend to be your friend. I'm going to be your mentor. I'm going to do all the things for you because I believe in you and you're so special. And then, you don't you ever, you know, like that attitude. And so when I see Dan doing that, my reaction is, oh, I never want an apology. You stay as far the fuck away from me as humanly possible for eternity.
Yeah.
I am scorched earth.
Like, I get that.
Don't even come up here.
I totally get that.
Yeah. And so it's, well, but it's different because
it is ultimately for him, his own ego. Yes. Like, even though it was sincere in the moment and he was desperate for redemption, he's looking for it from the wrong place.
Sure. Well,
and he's only desperate for redemption
so he can feel good about himself.
He's upset.
Yeah.
But isn't it crazy?
He took his anger out on the wrong person.
Yeah. All of our personal experiences color what we see three totally different ways.
Yeah.
Of course.
And, you know, for the audience of whatever, 2 million kids a week that were watching the show, who were they envisioning? Their teacher, their parent, you know, like their partner, whatever.
Yeah. I got emotional. I was watching that scene and I instantly got emotional. And you guys were like,
I got so nauseous. I'm still nauseous. Is my chest red? Like it was in the episode.
That was my favorite. I loved that scene between the two of you going to Brooke and Peyton in the bedroom because I loved, even though it was a little extra. I mean, that drama was so.
Like if I had slept with her husband and they had 4 children.
Yes.
Let's go there.
Yeah,
Scott, who we didn't even talk to in school last year.
Yeah.
We literally didn't even talk to this boy.
But your chest got so red.
Funny.
It's so funny that you were. Yeah. I love seeing that.
Well, yeah, because also there was this sense when they were writing all of the Peyton Brooke breakup stuff that like, we've done all this work to get over the competition, to get over the Team Brooke, Team Peyton of it all. And to know it was all falling apart, it felt physically bad.
Like, oh, it was heartbreaking.
It really, like, you know when your body chemicals are doing stuff when you're acting and you're like, I have zero control over this? It just feels toxic and kind of like acidic in your throat. And that was my reaction to all the Brooke, Peyton having to fight shit. And so like, I knew Sophia slapping me. Like, it was upsetting.
Yeah, it was awful.
Upset. And I liked that Peyton's reaction was like, I'm not going to react. I love you. I'm going to love you through this. And then it's like not working. And she finally reached her threshold. It's how I work with my kids. Like, my kids are farting around. I'm like, I'm going to let you have this moment. Okay, you slammed the door. You could, okay. You're going to throw hands? We're going to throw hands. That's what we're going to do. How long is this going to go on? Like, is there a clock on it? And then finally you hit your point where you're like, now I have to.
Now we're done.
Now I'm an asshole.
Yeah.
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 But that's important to parenting. Kids have to know when where their limit is.
Yeah, yeah.
That's part of the great thing about being a parent is that you're the safe place that the kids can go crazy, but they know that there will be a wall that they hit, and it's a boundary that feels safe. So they know what the rules are.
Yeah. Mm. I wanted to be soft and gentle like a parent with Brooke. But here's the thing. Okay, all right. We need to clean this up, though, because the audience has been giving me shit about this for so long.
Oh, what?
They're all like, I can't believe you would tell Brooke your feelings for Lucas. I'm like, yeah, because last time when Peyton didn't, she got in trouble for that.
Yeah.
So please,
yeah,
for the love of God, someone tell me what Peyton was supposed to do.
Yeah, for now, real.
Here's the thing. It's not actually that they're mad that you, that Peyton told Brooke, which, by the way, it's not that they're mad that Peyton told Brooke. It's that they're mad at the situation. Somebody being in love with their best friend's boyfriend, that's a shitty situation.
Even when she liked him first?
But,
ooh.
But you have, but she said she didn't. Brooke asked many times and Peyton said she
true.
Didn't. And that's
true.
The crux here.
Yeah.
Peyton was like, no, I don't, no, I don't, no, I don't. And but this is it, right?
Yeah.
People could see it. Mm-hmm. She didn't say it. I asked, but I couldn't see it. Mm-hmm. So everybody's right and everybody's wrong.
Yeah.
But I think what we really need to come to terms with is that somebody being in love with their best friend's partner is a shitty situation.
Yeah.
You don't have a good option and a bad option.
No.
You have a bad option and a worse option.
Yeah.
So lying about it and kissing Lucas behind Brooke's back, oof, worse option.
Terrible.
Telling Brooke you're in love with her boyfriend, bad option, but it's the better of the two options. So people need to stop saying, well, why would Peyton tell her? It's like, well, because at least she's being fucking honest.
Yeah, because what else are you supposed to do? Like, you can't live your life hanging out with your best friend and her boyfriend who you're in love with, and then you're like never quite yourself. And you, at the end of the day, you're either going to start distancing yourself from your friend because you just can't keep being around them.
No.
And then your friend's going to feel like, why did I lose my best friend?
Yeah.
Why are you being a weirdo?
Like, at least, mm-hmm. I mean, I think you did exactly the right thing. I think, what else was Peyton supposed to do?
Yeah, it's really weird to me when people want characters to be perfect, but they also watch their favorite characters for the drama.
Mm-hmm.
They watch for the conflict. They watch for the modeling of conflict resolution. And it's like, life is super messy.
Yeah.
You know, every single one of us has had our hearts completely broken by someone, and we've broken hearts.
Who? Us?
Oh, never.
No. Never.
You know, it's like you're never going to get through life without being wounded or without wounding someone else. The whole point is, how are you going to learn to show up, to be honest, to have grace for other people, to learn to have grace for yourself, to be a good friend, and to get through the mess in any measure of with any measure of honesty?
Yeah.
I'm just realizing that at our eighth grade dance, I was Peyton Sawyer. This
what?
Is horrible.
What did you do?
I was in love with this boy since kindergarten. Oh, loved him. Talk about him all the time. And he wanted to date my friend, and I wanted him to date my friend. Like, I wanted to be noble, like Peyton wanted to be noble. So I talked myself into going out with his best friend. Went out with his best friend, John. And we were going to go to the school dance.
Mm.
And I got to the school dance and John was wearing a new outfit and I was sick to my stomach because I was like, I don't really like this guy. I'm just trying to like who everyone told me to like. And is that what Peyton's doing with like it'd be easier for everyone if I was just with Pete or with Jake. Like, Jake's great, but like it would be easier for everyone if I picked someone no one wants to compete with.
Yeah.
I feel that way about Peyton and Pete for sure. I still feel like Peyton and Jake really had it, but then we lost Brian Greenberg to another job.
Energy,
and we had to pretend that Peyton didn't love Jake.
Yeah.
You know what I want for Peyton? Someone not from Tree Hill. Mm-hmm. Like, is there someone from New York City? Is there someone
from the OC?
You want somebody from Dawson's Creek?
That'd be fun.
Yeah. Is there someone who didn't grow up along that riverbank?
Yeah. Somebody.
It's important. Like the grown-up version of a foreign exchange student. That's who Peyton needs to be with.
Yeah.
Somebody who came from another country, speaks a couple of languages, should get a passport out of the second marriage.
That sounds so dope. It's like Lucas is her Lori, but she really needs to find her, what's his name, Frederick? Who was the guy Joe married?
Oh, yes. The hot older guy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right?
I mean, that's my vibe.
Yeah.
Whatever, man. Sometimes you got to take from life and turn it into art. God. Fine. So what else didn't we hit on this episode? I mean,
well,
your scene with Lucas where you're like, why don't you ever let me all the way in?
Ugh.
Sophia, there's a reason the fans post gifts of that and like put it up all the time. That was brutal. It was so sad. Scene.
I loved it. That was one of the best pieces of writing they had given me in 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Like I read that and thought, oh, I know this. Mm-hmm. This is important. Like, this isn't something I have to figure out how to be okay with doing.
Yeah.
You know, or like fight to make it better. I was like, no, this is true. This is like a true human experience. And yeah, I loved that scene.
What's so weird is that we have this episode about high schoolers getting married, so trying to act like grown-ups, but we see so many of our beloved high school girls acting like really little girls.
Mm.
Brooke is a little girl in this episode, and Rachel is a little girl in this episode.
Yeah.
And so it's, I don't know, that duality is kind of weird. It's like we've got babies getting married against the backdrop of babies crying.
Yeah.
Sad. Well,
and it's interesting because it is, there's an innocence to it and a desperation to be seen and loved and, you know, held and to feel safe. But I also think there's an inverse that is so mature to say, I see you and you don't see me.
Mm-hmm.
You tell me how you feel, but you don't act like it with me. And I know the difference. I'm smart enough to know the difference.
Yeah.
And I think there's something there, you know. We've talked a lot as we've been on tour about what the turning points have been for our characters. And I think about Brooke starting her business and beginning, you know, to stop letting boys define her as such a turning point. But I realize that even that scene between Brooke and Lucas is a turning point for her because she says, you tell me that you missed me, but you didn't call. You know, you say you needed to be alone, but I was going through this too, and you didn't care. And she's beginning to really assert that she deserves to be respected and included and acknowledged. And
being included's a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, especially when you're dating someone you're kind of insecure about. You know if they talk to their friends about you. You know if they like...
Boys are so dumb about that stuff, though. They don't know like how to... They're not emotionally intelligent generally.
I think that's a cop-out. I think that whole thing of like boys mature slower than girls. I'm like, or maybe they're just...
I don't think it has to do with maturing slower.
Pushed.
No, I think their brains are just... They just think differently. They're wired differently. So they don't think about like we are narratives, we're storytellers, we have a lot of this emotional connection instinct, and that's, again, like tribal from many, 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 many
Seriously,
years ago.
Sophia, as the mother of a boy, it's an evolutionary thing because there's no one more sensitive than my sweet son.
Yes.
There is no one with a more like feminist, let's talk about our feelings mother than my sweet son. One of his best friends, a female, gave him this whole speech about, you know, this pandemic was really hard and I just want you to know you're my best friend and I love you and like you're like, thank you for being safe for me. And my son looked at her and said, cool, and walked away.
Yeah.
And her mother called me and was like, you're not going to believe what your boy did. And it's because his brain couldn't understand the words and didn't know how to reciprocate.
Or he probably just received it all and he was like, Awesome. That means a lot. Thanks,
I feel
man.
The same.
Cool. Yeah. Cool. Cool.
He said cool.
The boys don't, they're oh, not like, they guess. Just don't
it's
know
not
how
malicious.
To,
it's not.
No, but that's where there's yeah. you have to learn each other's love language. You have to learn, like, how do I communicate with this person in a way that is a little outside of my comfort zone, but I know will be meaningful for them. That's
I think I should be more like that. I should talk less and just be like, cool.
Cool. Yeah.
That's what Brooke should have said. When Lucas came after her, she should have just turned around and been like, hey.
Cool.
We're with done the hand. We're done. With the hand up. Cool.
Cool.
We had fun in our hotel
I
room.
I loved that hotel, by the way.
Oh, guys, I just loved... I really would like to say thank you to the nice folks at the Omni, because having a bunch of adults say, can you please put us in rooms all side by side or all at the end of a hallway?
With connecting doors?
Yeah, it was probably so annoying, and they did it for us. And yeah. we got to just run around in those fluffy hotel robes
oh my gosh.
And like run in and out of each
in
other's rooms.
In four different cities. And those hotels, how about that Boston one though?
The Boston
was my favorite.
That was the coolest bathtub I think I've ever been in a hotel room.
And I took so many pictures of that bathroom.
The layout was amazing. The artwork mm-hmm. when you walk in.
Yeah.
No, I loved it.
That was gorgeous.
And I will say shout out to the folks at the Omni in DC, because I think by then they'd been watching our Instagram stories and realized we're a group who loves shenanigans. And they put a bottle of champagne in each of our rooms.
And a little
and
note.
And we got there and we were like, oh, you know who we are by the third city,
that's
don't
right.
you? And
that's
it was right. very sweet.
It was like they decorated the lobby of the New York Omni for us. It was like a drama queen set with like the chandeliers and all the flowers and all the things. And there was not one person that batted an eye when we were shooting content in the lobby, because they're like,
in robes.
Yeah. In robes and selfie dresses. They're like, of course these girls are here. Like,
yeah,
of course.
Where else would we be?
They were great. Thank you, guys.
All right, we're spinning a wheel. We have most likely to eat something off the ground.
Me.
Me.
It's definitely you two.
Yeah. It's us.
I mean, it's got to be clean. Like, I won't eat something off a really, like, an obviously dirty floor.
You but would.
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
I feel like I've heard you say, like, 12-second rule before.
Yeah, but if it's a floor that is clean, it's not clean-ish. Like a... I mean, if I drop down the floor of a restaurant, I'm not touching it.
Yeah. Or
what's
like,
your cutoff? Like, airport?
No, yeah, airport, no way. No, like a public place where there's a lot of foot traffic, I don't know. There's no way.
See, that depends
on... But in my own house,
what
sure.
What is it made of? Like, if I'm...
Porous, not porous.
Yeah, like if we were, for example, walking down the hallway and I had like those peanut butter pretzels and I dropped them, I'd pick them up and eat them off the floor.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Yes,
but
yes,
I'm
yes.
not gonna like, I'm not gonna drop sliced apples on the ground. Like
no.
they're wet.
Porous,
they're gonna pick up
porous.
Something.
Yeah, nothing
that's
with
a
wet.
No.
Lint, hey, if it can pick up
nope.
lint, no.
Yeah,
right.
it's a pass.
Got to have a hard shell like an M&M.
Agree.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm glad
now
we have
our
boundaries now.
Yeah.
We're all cleared up. Oh, guys, thank you so much for joining us for this finale episode. We can't wait to start season 4 with all of you. I'm excited to see season 4. There's so many
season
new things coming
four.
Up.
Yeah, we're flying through stuff.
Yep, absolutely.
Guys, our next episode is going to be the premiere of season 4. It is called The Same Deep Water as You, and I have a feeling we're going to pick up in a limo in the river.
Something tells me.
Something tells me. Can't wait.
See you then.
Hey, thanks for listening.
Don't forget to leave us a review. You can also follow us on Instagram at DramaQueensOTH.
Or email us at DramaQueens@iHeartRadio.com.
See you next time. We're all about that high school drama girl, all about them high school queens. We'll take you for a ride in our comic girl,
drama girl.
Cheering for the right team. Drama.